knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
As we just discussed, forensic science is all about applying different scientific techniques to matters under legal investigation. Evidence found on the scene of the crime will help us determine certain things empirically. But first, it is essential to understand the basics of what constitutes a crime and what establishes a crime. The liability of a crime is expressed by the following Latin phrase: Actus reus non facit, reum nisi mens sit rea, which means an act does not deserve blame unless the mind is guilty. Now, let us look at the sentence again. In it, there is an emphasis on the following two phrases: actus reus and mens rea. In short, actus reus means guilty act, and mens rea means guilty mind. Now let us understand the definition of crime. First, the notion that acts such as theft, murder, and rape are prohibited is universally accepted. What makes such acts a criminal offense is the law of the land. Every state has the right to restrict a person's liberty if they commit a crime. A crime is said to have been committed when a voluntary act or omission is accompanied by a specific state of mind. To put it simply, crime is a guilty act, actus reus, or the act of doing something criminal, which is against the law, done by a guilty mind, mens rea, or the intention of doing something criminal. Thus, these are the two elements of a crime. It is not a crime to merely have guilty thoughts. Those guilty thoughts must be linked to a guilty act. Both must be present simultaneously, or a crime is not committed. Some jurisdictions consider this concurrence of both actus reus and mens rea as separate elements of a crime. Let us illustrate with a few examples. Let's say person X shoots person Y with the intent to kill, and the bullet lodges into Y's heart. Here, both guilty mind and guilty act are present. Hence, X has committed a crime and will be convicted of murder. In another example, X shoots Y with the intent to kill, but misses completely. X then accidentally runs over Y in their car, resulting in Y's death. Here, the guilty thoughts and the guilty act are completely disconnected. They are not present simultaneously. Therefore, X will not be convicted for murder. To put it differently, we don't punish those that we don't see as blameworthy. This is the reason why criminal liability does not attach to a person who has acted as a result of mental inability. This is a general rule from most jurisdictions all over the world, and we will expand on this when we examine forensic psychology. However, certain crimes don't require a mens rea. That is, they are crimes that you can't escape even if you didn't intend anything wrong. You are held liable regardless of your intentions. These crimes are known as strict liability crimes, and they are very common. You might even have committed some of them unknowingly. Some examples are speeding or running a red light. You may not intend to run a red light, but nevertheless, it happens. Some serious offenses could be selling alcohol and other substances of abuse to minors. In exceptional circumstances, a guilty act may not be directly committed with the absence of any intention. A specific example is a commander being held criminally responsible for the guilty acts committed by their subordinates. Sometimes, failure to act may also constitute a guilty act. For example, failure to fill out an income tax return. To illustrate further, a lifeguard who intentionally lets a person drown in a swimming pool is criminally liable, as the failure to act and guilty intent exist together. Guilty intent can also be classified into two parts: general intent and specific intent. In crimes related to general intent, the prosecution does not need to establish that the defendant intended the precise outcome of the act. This sounds very similar to strict liability, but let us go deeper. Strict liability, as we saw, is when a guilty act is committed and the intentions are absent. However, in general intent crimes, the intention to commit the act is present, even if there is no intention to violate the law. Therefore, the guilty intent is not required to be specifically proven. A person throwing acid on another person's face is guilty without specifically proving the intent. They have committed a crime by the sole virtue of the fact that they voluntarily committed it. On the other hand, in specific intent crimes, merely establishing the general intent is not enough. Burglary is a crime that involves illegal entry into a home to commit a crime, especially theft. Here, merely breaking into the house is general intent and is not enough to constitute a crime. The specific crime committed after breaking in is what constitutes specific intent. To summarize, the general intent is when committing the act is enough, while specific intent is when the specific proof is needed. This is where evidence comes in. Forensic science is used to establish actus reus and mens rea by analyzing evidence present on the scene, followed by establishing the specific intent of the suspect. Now that we have understood the basics of crime, let us classify crime into different types. According to their nature, crimes can be classified into crimes against persons, crimes against property, crimes against morality, hate crimes, white-collar crimes, and organized crimes. Crimes against persons, also called personal crimes, involve offenses with intent to cause bodily harm or a threat of bodily harm to a person. Some offenses that constitute bodily harm are murder, rape, robbery, assault, kidnapping, etc., while offenses like stalking and harassment include the threat of bodily harm. Crimes against property involve the theft of property without any intended bodily harm. The main intent in these crimes is gratification in the form of money, property, or some other benefit. These crimes can be divided into two groups: stolen property and destroyed property. Theft, burglary, and larceny are some offenses that involve stolen property, while arson and vandalism are said to have been committed when the property under investigation is destroyed. Crimes against morality are those crimes that do not involve a specific victim. Therefore, these are also known as victimless crimes. So if there are no victims, whom do these crimes affect? The answer is society. These crimes allegedly threaten the moral values of society. One important characteristic of these crimes is that most of the people involved are consenting adults. Examples of these crimes, according to certain governing bodies, can include pornography, illegal gambling, prostitution, and illegal drug use. Hate crimes are those crimes that involve crimes against persons as well as property, but they involve a specific intent that is a result of the prejudices of the perpetrator against the victim. Before 2009, FBI investigations of hate crimes were limited to bias against the victim's race, color, religion, or national origin. But after the passing of the Hate Crimes Prevention Act in 2009, these crimes have been extended to the grounds of actual or perceived sexual orientation, disability, gender, and gender identity. However, one thing to mention here is that hate itself is not a crime, being mindful of personal liberties. White-collar crimes are financially motivated and non-violent crimes committed by white-collar workers, meaning employees earning higher than average salaries by doing highly skilled work with no manual labor involved. They include corruption, money laundering, wage theft, frauds, cybercrime, Ponzi schemes, and so forth. A point to note is that these crimes are far from victimless. A single scam may destroy a company and devastate families, affecting thousands of people. Finally, organized crimes involve highly coordinated crimes committed by a particular organization of criminals. A criminal organization can also be referred to as a gang, mafia, mob, ring, or syndicate. Most of them are politically, financially, or communally motivated. They commit crimes in the form of violence, financial and white-collar crimes, drug trafficking, human trafficking, cybercrime, terrorism, and more. In this tutorial, we have tried to understand the essentials of crime and its classification. Different pieces of evidence are specific to each type of crime committed, and further investigation is carried out accordingly. As we move forward, we will be examining the types of evidence, their nature and classification, and related investigative procedures.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.